Flame tests and their line spectra are a popular way of showing evidence for the quantized nature of the atom, but sometimes you want something even simpler to demonstrate a complex idea, such as a colored LED lighting up, or not. This month we're going to look at what LEDs can teach us about electronic transitions. The equipment you'll need is provided in the accompanying exhibition chemistry article. Before we get onto that though, let's first take a look at the spectrum from a tungsten bulb for comparison. I'm using a diffraction grating here with 600 lines per millimeter. At low power, we get a very red color from the bulb, but we still get a spread of colors in the spectrum, mostly red of course. As I increase the power by adjusting the rheostat, we get more and more colors in the spectrum and the color of the bulb becomes more yellow. Now let's repeat the same thing with a red LED. Make sure you connect the long leg to the positive terminal as current can only flow through one way. Your LED will need a protecting resistor in place. I'm using a 55 ohm rheostat, but you might have little kits like this already made up, or even a dedicated Planck's constant kit. It's worth asking somebody in your physics department because they probably do a similar experiment with their students. The first thing I notice is that as the voltage increases, there's no current flowing initially, unlike the bulb. Eventually we get some light and the current increases. The spectrum this time is much more focused, more like the line spectra we see from flame tests, but not perfect in this regard, because we're not dealing with energy levels in gaseous atoms. But we can use this LED to model an electronic transition. In the circuit, the rate of flow of electrons through is shown by the ammeter, and the voltmeter reading shows the energy per coulomb the electrons transfer between the two points where it's connected. Within the LED, there's an energy barrier similar to the energy levels in atoms. An electron requires a minimum amount of energy to overcome it. As electrons cross the barrier, a photon of light is released of a frequency proportional to its size. So what's going to happen if I swap this red LED for a higher frequency one, such as this green LED? With the same voltage, that is to say energy per unit of charge, the electrons can't cross the barrier. No current flows, and no light is released. As you increase the voltage, each electron has more energy, and so the electrons can cross the barrier, allowing a current to flow and causing the higher frequency LED to illuminate. This demonstrates that lower frequencies are associated with less energy, and that if the minimum energy criteria for the transition isn't met, electrons can't jump the energy barrier. As you increase the voltage, the current increases proportionally, and the LED gets brighter as more and more electrons possess the necessary energy to make the jump. I made a note of the voltages and currents as I adjusted the variable resistor. Now obviously we can't see the photon associated with the jump of a single electron, but we can estimate the voltage at which that jump becomes possible by forecasting the linear part of the IV graph I just made back to where that transition occurs at almost zero current. You can download a copy of this spreadsheet for use with your classes. The energy transferred by an electron is the product of its charge, 1.67 times 10 to the minus 19 coulombs, and the potential difference across which it moves. The value from this graph corresponds with an energy value of 3 times 10 to the minus 19 joules, which students can convert to a wavelength of around 650 nanometers, a 14% difference from the advertised 568 nanometers. Here, the regression from multiple measurements reduces random errors, but the value determined suffers from a systematic error, resulting from the assumption that the LED is 100% efficient.